गुड मॉर्निंग एवरी वन. टूडेज टॉपिक इज आर्बोवायरसेस. सो दीज आर्बोवायरसेस आर नथिंग बट दीज आर द एक्रोनिम्स. दिस इज द एक्रोनिम फॉर आर्थ्रोपोड बॉर्न वायरसेस. सो बिफोर गोइंग इन टू द टॉपिक लेट सी हाउ द एनिमल्स हैव कॉज्ड और कॉजिंग फैटेलिटी इन द ह्यूमन्स. Though it is a rough calculation with wide error, just we'll have a brief idea how the animal fatalities are causing to the mankind. Actually, you might have seen in films, many films, like for example, Jaws, they give an impression that sharks are the man-eating animals. But when it comes to the animal responsible for the most human fatalities each year, nothing comes close to matching the mosquito. So according to Gates notes, 725,000 people are killed by devastating diseases carried by mosquitoes per year. 725,000 people. Whereas coming to snakes, they cause around 50,000 fatalities every year. While dogs, for example, if you take, they kill people of around 25,000, primarily through rabies. So mosquitoes are the greatest killers for the mankind. So while the whole world feared Alexander, but still he was defeated by the mosquito. Actually, they said according to author Andrew Chuck that Alexander died of malaria, having contracted it 2 weeks before his death while sailing in the marshes to inspect flood defenses. But though there are other causes of Alexander's death like alcohol, liver disease, fever, strychnine poisoning, but little data support those versions. But mostly everyone believe that the death of Alexander was due to malaria. So, and mosquitoes has that power to cause human fatalities. So what are these arthropods? These are arboviruses, diverse group of RNA viruses that are transmitted to blood-sucking arthropods, which are the insect vectors, from one vertebrate host to another. So these arboviruses, they must multiply inside the insects, and they establish a lifelong harmless infection in them. Whereas viruses that are just mechanically transmitted by the insects are not included in this group. Okay, remember this. Viruses must multiply in the insects and they should establish a lifelong harmless infection in them. Okay. So other than these arboviruses, we have something called as robovirus, that is rodent borne viruses, which are maintained in nature by direct transmission from rodent to rodent by the contact of body fluids or excretions of the infected rodents. It is not transmitted by arthropods. Remember this, it is not transmitted by arthropods. So coming to arbovirus per se. So members of this arbovirus, they belong to 5 different families like Togaviridae, Flaviviridae, Bunyaviridae, Rhabdoviridae and Rheoviridae. This family Togaviridae includes genus Alphavirus, whereas family Flaviviridae includes Flavivirus. Bunyaviridae has genus Orthobunyavirus, Nirovirus, Flebovirus and Tospovirus. Whereas Rhabdoviridae includes Vesiculovirus and Rheoviridae has genus Orbivirus and Coltivirus. So in this class we'll see only about Togaviridae and in the next class we'll continue with the Flaviviridae. So we are concerned only with the Togaviridae for today, that too Alphavirus. Okay. So coming to the family Togaviridae, it has few viruses like chikungunya virus, onyongnyong virus, Mayaro virus, Rose River, Sinbi, Semliki, Forest virus, Eastern, Western and Venezuelan equine encephalitis virus. Okay. So these are few viruses which belongs to the family Togaviridae and they cause clinical manifestations like fever, arthritis, arthralgia, rashes and encephalitis. So the distribution of the viruses of this Togaviridae is mostly Asia, Africa, South America, Australia, Europe. Okay. And the vector for these diseases are Aedes aegypti, Anopheles, Culex. Okay. So these are the mosquitoes which act as vectors. And the reservoirs being monkeys or small animals, birds, mammals, rodents, horses. Okay. So these all virus come under Togaviridae family, that is chikungunya, Sinbis virus, Emlicky forest virus, eastern, western and Venezuelan equine encephalitis virus. So though we are dealing only with Togaviridae in this class, just we'll go through the names of other families of arbovirus. So coming to family Flaviviridae, it includes Japanese bee encephalitis virus, St. Louis, West Nile, Murray Valley encephalitis viruses, Roscio virus and Russian spring summer encephalitis virus. Okay, so in detail about this family we'll see in the next class. So apart from these virus, there are also few virus which are included in Flaviviridae, that is Powassan virus, Looping Ill, Dengue virus, Yellow fever, Kyasanur forest disease virus, OMSK hemorrhagic fever virus and Zika virus. Okay, then family Bunyaviridae includes California encephalitis virus, Oropouch virus, Sandfly fever, Rift Valley fever virus, Crimean Congo hemorrhagic fever, Ganjam virus and severe fever with thrombocytopenia syndrome virus. Okay, coming to family Rioviridae, it includes Colorado tick fever virus, Orungo virus and Kemerovo virus. And family Rhabdoviridae includes vesicular stomatitis virus and Chandipura virus. Okay, so this, how are these viruses are placed under each family of these arthropods based on the various features, like for example clinical features, like yellow, suppose if we take the example of yellow fever, it is named after its clinical clinical presentation of jaundice. Example, if you take Kyasanur forest disease, it is named after the place of its discovery. Okay, Kyasanur, it is place in Karnataka. And when we take sandfly virus, it is it's so named because of the vector which is needed for its transmission, that is sandfly. And based on the seasons also, like Russian spring summer encephalitis virus, because it is more prevalent in spring and summer seasons. And also Japanese encephalitis, it is named based on this place of discovery and also the clinical features caused by it. Okay, so in this way the individual virus under individual viruses under each family are named. So this arthropod bone bone infections, these are hematophagous vectors. Hematophagous means they feed on the blood. And the distribution of this arboviral infections is worldwide, especially in the tropical zones. And till now, more than 500 arboviruses have been discovered. And coming to India, more than 40 arboviruses have been detected, out of which 10 of them are pathogenic to humans. And these infections, they multiply in the arthropods. Okay, these viruses, they multiply in the arthropods like mosquitoes, ticks, sandfly. Okay, so they act as vectors. So coming to the vectors now, like I already said, few mosquitoes like Aedes, Culex, ticks and phlebotomus, that is sandfly. So first, coming to the mosquitoes, we have three species, that is Aedes, Anopheles and Culex mosquitoes, which cause various arboviral diseases. Okay, not only arboviral diseases, few other diseases, but here we are concerned only with arthropod bone infections. Okay, so when we in Aedes, we have Aedes aegypti, Aedes albopictus, and in Culex we have Culex diatorhynchus and Quinquefasciaticus and Annuli rostris. Okay, these are the species of few species of Culex. So coming to Aedes mosquito causes few diseases like dengue fever, yellow fever, Rift Valley fever and chikungunya. Okay, coming to Culex, it causes few diseases like West Nile virus, Rift Valley fever, Murray Valley encephalitis, Western equine encephalitis and Japanese encephalitis. So apart from this arbovirus diseases, Anopheles mosquito causes malaria. Okay, and also Culex mosquito resides in the dog head heartworm, that is gyrophilaria. Okay, but here we are concerned only with arthropod bone infections. So this is about the mosquitoes acting as vectors. Coming to the tick, again in tick we have heart tick and soft tick. Hard tick is Ixodes capillaris, whereas soft tick is Ornithodorus hermsi. Okay. So the diseases transmitted by these ticks are tick typhus, viral encephalitis, viral fevers, viral hemorrhagic fevers, tularemia, tick paralysis, and human babesiosis. These are all the diseases, combining arthropod diseases also. And soft tick causes Q fever and relapsing fever. Then coming to sandfly, actually sandfly are the vectors of many diseases which are of public health importance, like Kala Azar, Oriental Sore, or sandfly fever. So the scientific name of the sandfly is, it can be the Phlebotomus or Ludzomia. Okay. So coming to the transmission cycles of arthropod bone infections, it can occur in two ways. That is, one is from man arthropod and again to man, and the other one is animal arthropod and man. So first coming to man arthropod man cycle, here the reservoir can be either man or the arthropod vector. Okay, example, this type of cycle is seen in dengue or urban yellow fever. And here, when the reservoir is in arthropod vector, here transovarial transmission can take place. Transovarial transmission means transmission from the parent to the offspring via ovaries. It occurs in certain arthropod vectors as they transmit pathogens from parent arthropod to the offspring arthropod. So coming to the other type of cycle, it is animal arthropod man cycle. Here the reservoir is an animal and the virus is maintained in nature in a transmission cycle involving the arthropod vector and the animal. But man, he becomes infected incidentally. Example of these type of cycle is Japanese encephalitis, Eastern equine encephalitis, Western equine encephalitis, and yellow fever. So when we take yellow fever, sometimes animal arthropod man cycle or man arthropod man cycle can also be seen. So both cycles may be seen with few arboviruses such as yellow fever. This is about the transmission. Then coming to the pathogenesis, so how does the virus enter into the body? Through the bite of the insect vector, it enters into the bloodstream, and from there it multiplies into the reticuloendothelial system, causing viremia, and it affects the target organs, like CNS is affected in encephalitis, liver in yellow fever, capillary endothelium in hemorrhagic fevers. Okay. Then these arboviruses can also be divided based on the pattern of clinical syndromes they produce. Like few arthropods, they can produce fever and rash, or fever without rash, or with arthralgia or without arthralgia. And also it can cause encephalitis or hemorrhagic fevers also. Some arboviral diseases, they may have more than one clinical manifestations. Like example, dengue. When we take, they have more than one clinical manifestations. So this is in general about arboviral infections. Till now we haven't gone to toga virus. Okay. So coming to the lab diagnosis, so these arboviruses, they can be isolated from clinical specimens like blood, CSF, or tissue homogenates by the following methods. First is, when we take animal inoculation, it can be either through intracerebral inoculation of the suckling mice, where the animals develop fatal encephalitis, or it can also be done through this route, that is mosquito inoculation. Or it can also be through tissue cultures like vero cell line, mosquito cell line, such as C6 by 36 and AP61, that is Aedes pseudoscutularis 61. Okay, this is about the viral isolation. This is in general for arboviral infections. Okay, this lab diagnosis. Then coming to the detection of antigen, here NS1 antigen and also group specific antigens like flavivirus antigens. This NS1 antigen can be detected in blood, whereas group specific antigens like flavivirus antigens, they can be detected in peripheral leukocytes, liver, lung, lymph nodes, spleen, and also bone marrow. Apart from this, molecular methods are also being done to diagnose arboviral diseases like reverse transcriptase PCR. This has been developed to amplify the RNA which is present in the clinical specimens. Whereas coming to real-time reverse transcriptase PCR, here it has the advantage over this reverse transcriptase PCR because it can quantify the viral load in the blood. So mostly this is used to monitor the progression of the disease. And the advantages of this molecular methods are they are highly sensitive, specific, and also they are rapid. And also they are used to detect serotypes. Okay, example in dengue, there are 4 serotypes, so it can be detected only by molecular methods. But disadvantages are these molecular methods, they are very much prone for contamination and also the cost factor. So because of the cost factor, these actually are not widely used for detecting the arboviral infections. So apart from this, we have newer methods and most commonly used one, that is ELISA, which can be either IgG or IgM specific, and also ICT, that is immunochromatographic based assay. This test can be used to differentiate IgM and IgG separately. Okay. So coming to the epidemiology, actually we have covered many things in epidemiology, but still we'll go through this. So the arboviral diseases are mostly zoonotic, that is mainly they are maintained in the animals. Exceptions to these are dengue and onyong-nyong virus. Okay. Infection is asymptomatic in animals and they maintain in a cycle by a cycle involving mosquitoes or other arthropod vectors. And man is the accidental host. Okay. And coming to the human spread, it is through vector bite or through animal reservoir. And the infection is maintained in a cycle composed of humans and domestic mosquitoes. So in tick-borne infection is maintained by transovarial transmission until it finds a new host. Okay, so it is maintained by transovarial transmission. So coming to the arboviral infections which are present in, which are seen mostly in India. In Toga virus, chikungunya and Sinbi's virus, these are mostly predominant in India. Apart from this, we have dengue virus, Japanese bee encephalitis and Kyasanur forest disease, which are more commonly seen in India. Apart from this, there are also few arbovirus infections, but most commonly these are the arbovirus infections seen in India. So, then just a few points about rodent-borne viruses, that is roboviruses. Here we have family Arenaviridae, Bunyaviridae and Phyloviridae. In Arenaviridae, we have genus Arenavirus, which includes the viruses which are New World and also Old World viruses. New World viruses includes Guanarito, Junin, Machupo, Sabia and Whitewater Oreo viruses. Whereas old viruses includes Lassa virus and lymphocytic chorio-meningitis viruses. Whereas Bunyaviridae, which includes genus Hantavirus, includes Hantan virus, that is Korean hemorrhagic fever, and hemorrhagic fever with renal syndrome, that is with Siol virus, and Synnombre virus, that is Hantavirus pulmonary syndrome. Then coming to Phyloviridae, which includes genus Marburg virus and genus Ebola virus. Okay, which includes Marburg viruses and Ebola viruses. These are just few viruses belonging to rodent-borne viruses. Okay. So coming to Togaviridae, so morphology is, it is spherical in shape and it measures around 50 to 70 nanometers. These are enveloped viruses. Okay. And it includes single-stranded positive sense RNA and replication of this occurs in cytoplasm. Okay. So Togaviridae includes two genuses. One is alpha virus and other one is rubivirus. This genus rubivirus contains which virus? Contains rubella virus. So which is not arthropod transmitted and it is not an arbovirus. So in this class we will see only about genus alpha virus. So this genus alpha virus, it contains about 30 different mosquito borne viruses, out of which about only 13 are human pathogens. And all these alpha viruses are serologically related. And they are categorized into these two groups. One is fever arthritis group and the other one is encephalitis group. So in this we'll see little in detail about chikungunya virus. So the name chikungunya is derived from the Markande word, that is Kanganyala. Kanganyala, okay. So Markande is nothing but it is an ethnic group in southeast Tanzania, Mozambique and Kenya. So which means bends up or gets folded. It is so named because of the stooped posture which develops as a result of severe joint pains that occur during this course of illness of chikungunya. So this chikungunya belongs to the family Togaviridae, genus alpha virus, and it is transmitted by Aedes mosquitoes, Aedes aegypti primarily, and also by Aedes albopictus, which is a mutated form. So it is by the bite of Aedes aegypti during the daytime mostly, okay, and there is no human to human transmission, and rarely vertical transmission from mother to fetus can occur or by blood transfusion, although it is very rare. So most commonly it is transmitted by the bite of Aedes aegypti mosquito and also sometimes by Aedes albopictus, which is a mutated form. So this chikungunya, it is a mosquito-borne viral disease which was first described during an outbreak in southern Tanzania in 1952. Okay, so it was not considered to be fatal that time, but however, in around 2005 to 2006, it has caused many deaths, most commonly in Reunion Island. It resulted in more than 200 deaths. That time it was known to be a fatal mosquito-borne viral disease. Okay, so around more than 200 deaths have been associated with chikungunya on this island, Reunion Island. Geographically, it is distributed in Africa and Southeast Asia. In India, first outbreak of chikungunya occurred in 1963. And also from that time, major epidemics appeared cyclically. Okay, and first case in Mauritius also was discovered around this period only, 2005 to 2006. So coming to the transmission cycle of chikungunya, here you have two cycles. One is sylvatic, sorry for the spelling mistake here, sylvatic, okay, S-Y. One is the sylvatic cycle and the other one is the urban cycle. So the sylvatic cycle, it occurs in African forest. Here the wild primates, that is monkeys, they act as reservoir. So the transmission takes place between wild primates and also Aedes mosquitoes, which resides mostly in African forests. Whereas coming to urban cycle, it occurs during epidemics and human beings act as reservoir. In sylvatic cycle, wild primates or monkeys acted as reservoir, whereas here humans, they serve as reservoir. And transmission occurs between humans and Aedes mosquitoes. It can be Aedes aegypti and also Aedes albopictus. So this is about the transmission cycle of chikungunya virus. Coming to the clinical manifestations, incubation period of this is 5 days. Mostly it ranges from 3 to 7 days. So it is characterized by either fever and also joint pains. Fever, it is usually very high and poorly responsive to antipyretics. Coming to the joint pains, that is arthralgia, actually it is acute bilateral and symmetrical rheumatism. Here peripheral joints are frequently very painful and swollen, especially interphalangeal joints, wrists and ankles. And also the the proximal joints, they can become inflamed with large joint effusions in the knees and also elbows. So it is also polyarticular, mostly they involve small joints. So other symptoms like headache, muscular pain, tenosynovitis and also skin rashes can be seen. Mostly patients recover within a week except for the joint pains. Okay. So these features of chikungunya almost coincide with the feature of dengue fever. So here are few common features between chikungunya and dengue fever. So coming to the fever. Fever and myalgia, it is common in both the conditions, okay. And coming to the rash, it is seen on the day 1 to day 4 in chikungunya, whereas in dengue from day 5 to day 7. Retroorbital pain, is very common in dengue, whereas it is very rare in chikungunya. And coming to arthralgia and tenosynovitis, arthritis, these are common for chikungunya, whereas these are very rare or absent for dengue virus. Coming to the hypotension, it is possible in chikungunya virus, whereas in dengue, hypotension is very common, which occurs between the day 5 to day 7. Hypotension and also minor bleeding. And outcome of this chikungunya is Raynaud's syndrome. Possibly it can be Raynaud's syndrome, tenosynovitis, or common persistence of arthralgia for months to years. And the outcome of dengue is possible fatigue for weeks. So it is not that severe when compared to chikungunya. Coming to thrombocytopenia, it is very mild, whereas it is very severe in dengue cases. So coming to the complications of this chikungunya, CNS can cause convulsions, meningoencephalitis and GB syndrome, and few other complications like myocarditis, fulminant hepatitis in patients with chronic liver diseases, pancreatitis, acute endocrine disorders, extensive epidermolysis, kidney failure, respiratory failure, or even cardiovascular diseases. So there are three genotypes of this chikungunya virus, that is West African, East African and Asian genotype. So most Indian cases before 1973 were due to this Asian genotype. However, when outbreak in Reunion Island occurred, it was caused due to a mutated strain and is responsible for most of the current outbreaks in India and also in other parts of the world. So how is this genotype distribution? It is due to differences in the transmission cycle. Okay, it is due to differences in the transmission cycles. For example, human cycle in Asia and forest cycle in Africa. Okay. And I already said that this is a re-emerging disease, chikungunya. Why it has been re-emerged? Because of a new mutation and also new vector. New vector we have already seen, Aedes albopictus. It is a mutated form. So this mutated form was found to be 100 times more infective than to Aedes aegypti. So new mutation here, what happened? Chikungunya virus, it underwent a mutation in which alanine amino acid in 226 position of E1 glycoprotein gene is replaced by valine. Okay, so because of this reasons it has been re-emerged. Then coming to the lab diagnosis, viral isolation can be done in mosquito cell lines, and also you can go for real-time reverse transcriptase PCR, which are best for early diagnosis, that is within 7 days of the infection. And also antibody detection in the serum can be done. Like IgM, it appears after 4 days of infections and it lasts for 3 months. Whereas IgG, it appears late, that is after 2 weeks, and it lasts for years. So detection of this IgM or fourfold increase in the IgG titer is more significant in diagnosing this infection. And also we have something called as MAC ELISA, which captures IgM antibody. Okay, it is the best format because it has high sensitivity and specificity, and it has only little cross reactivity with other alpha viruses. So in India, this MAC ELISA kits, these are supplied by NIV, that is National Institute of Virology, Pune. And apart from this, we have also few ICT test kits, that is rapid tests using envelope antigens. These are widely available. So samples collected during the first week after the onset of the symptoms should be tested by both serological methods and also molecular methods like RT-PCR. So this RT-PCR, it is used to detect specific genes like NSP1 gene, NSP4 gene in the blood. Apart from this, there are few biological markers which are raised, that is interleukin 1 beta, interleukin 6, which are raised, and RANT is, that is regulated on activation, normal, T cell expressed and secreted. These levels are decreased, whereas interleukin 1 beta and interleukin 6 levels are increased. Apart from this, there are few non-specific findings like leukopenia, with increased lymphocytes and thrombocytopenia, which is very rare, and also increased ESR and CRP. Then coming to the treatment, there are no specific antiviral drugs available. So the treatment is only based on supportive measures. So it is limited to painkillers and NSAIDs, that is non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. Acetaminophen is the commonly used drug. Aspirin should be avoided because of the risk of bleeding, and corticosteroids are not to be recommended because of the commonest side effect, that is it can cause a rebound effect after the stopping of the drug. So apart from the treatment, there are few vaccine trials which are going on. So in one of the trial, a live measles vaccine virus, that is Schwartz strain, is used as a vector into the genome of which 5 structural genes from chikungunya viruses are incorporated. Okay, so this is about in detail about chikungunya. And now few points about other alpha viruses. First, Synbis virus. So Synbis virus, it causes chikungunya like illness only, characterized by arthralgia and rash. It is transmitted by Culex mosquito. So it is caused by different it is called by different names like Pogosta disease, Karelian fever and Ockelbo disease. Okay, in India, though the virus has been isolated, it is not associated with any human disease till now. Okay, coming to Semliki forest virus, it is first isolated from Aedes mosquito in the Semliki forest, Uganda, and since then it is confined only to Africa. It causes lethal encephalitis in rodents. Okay, its pathogenicity to humans is still doubtful. So because of its broad host range and efficient replication, it is used as vector for the genes encoding various vaccines, and it also acts as anti-cancer agent. So it is a tool for gene therapy also. Then coming to few other alpha viruses, Onyongnyong virus, this virus is closely related to chikungunya virus, that is it causes symptoms like rashes, arthralgia. Okay, but however it is transmitted by Anopheles mosquito, whereas chikungunya is transmitted by Anopheles mosquito, and its infection is confined to Africa. Coming to other virus, Myaro virus, it is also a chikungunya like illness only. Aedes aegypti may be involved in human transmission, okay, in an urban cycle. So it is mostly affecting South American countries. Coming to Ross River virus, the other name of this Ross River virus is, it was earlier known as epidemic polyarthritis in Australia and New Guinea, and this is transmitted by several Aedes mosquitoes like Aedes polynesiensis and Aedes aegypti. So focal cases of this Rose River viruses were reported in India from Pune in around 2010. So these are the viruses belonging to the fever arthritis group of alpha virus. Then we have something called as encephalitis group of the alpha viruses. Here it includes eastern, western and venulin equine encephalitis viruses. So this eastern equine encephalitis viruses, these are very rare and severe, and the bird mosquito cycle is by Culicetta, and the transmission to mammals is by Aedes vexans. Whereas western equine encephalitis virus, these are common and they are mostly infected to infants. Okay, so it is by the bite of Culex tarsalis. Whereas coming to venulin equine encephalitis, it is mild to serious form, and it is by the bite of Culex tenopius and Aedes tenorhynchus. So this equine, it is also used as a biological weapon. Okay, so coming to the vaccines, inactivated vaccines have been developed for both eastern and western equine encephalitis, whereas for venulin equine encephalitis, there are both live attenuated and also inactivated vaccine available. So as there is no specific treatment available and there are no vaccinations till now for these kind of infections, So the best thing is to prevent. So how to prevent? It's usually by mosquitoes. So vector control measures, which includes mostly mosquito control, are required to reduce the transmission of disease by arbovirus. So firstly, removal of other pools of stagnant waters, like in old tires, large outdoor potted plants, empty cans, etc., because they often act as the breeding grounds for mosquitoes. Whereas insecticides can be applied in rural areas and also urban areas, inside the houses or in outdoor environments. So they are quite effective and useful in controlling the arthropod infections. Though some of the chemicals like DDT and organophosphates have been banned in many countries, and some countries, what do they do? They introduce the infertile male mosquitoes in some areas to reduce the breeding rate of the mosquito species. And apart from this, larvicides also can be used worldwide in the mosquito abatement programs. So in this way, vectors can be controlled by vector control measures, okay, mostly to control mosquito population and in turn to reduce the transmission of disease by arbovirus infections. Okay, so now there is a word search puzzle. Okay, so everybody should write the answers for this in the comment section with your roll numbers. Okay, identify as many words as possible from today's class only. It is everything related to arbovirus only. Okay, I want everyone to write this. Identify as many words as possible. I'll give you just 5 minutes. Attendance will be given only to those who answer this. Okay, so 2 more minutes. If not in the comment section, then you can post in our WhatsApp group also, okay, with your roll numbers. लास्ट 1 मिनट Very good, you people are coming out with answers. Yes, I could see, I can see only two of them responding. Yes, very good. There are many guys, try to attempt. Yes, very good, very good. So there are about 10 words, okay? Try to identify those. 10 or more, but minimum is 10. So identify those 10 words which are related to this arbovirus. Okay, so for those people who have not answered in the comment section, they can answer in the WhatsApp group, okay, with your roll numbers. After you people post the answers, I'll post you the key, okay. Okay, then we'll see the okay, still people are posting, commenting in the comment section. Okay, good. And the remaining ones, please post in the WhatsApp group, okay? So today we'll end this class. Thank you.